Well, the Winston World Championship battles appeared to be over in Funny Car and Pro Stock, but not among the kings of the sport. With his record rampage and his victory, Darrell Gwynn, for the first time since the Cajuns, moved into a position to challenge for the title.
Two races remained on the national event circuit as the Tour pulled into Phoenix, Arizona, and the Castrol GTX Fall Nationals at Firebird Raceway. Gene Snow debuted a brand new car just one race ago, and in doing so, set the low ET mark in qualifying at the Chief National. At the Fall Nationals, he came in the number two qualifier on this run, but he also had some engine problems and an ensuing fire. Snow brought the car to a safe stop. He came back in eliminations and made it to the second round, where he lost to Eddie Hill. Kenny Bernstein clinched his funny car title at Phoenix as he lost to Ed McCulloch. Just qualifying and making the first round won the title for Bernstein. The drama still centered on Top Fuel and what had to be done to win the world championship.
In 1977, Shirley Muldowney became the first woman to win a major auto racing world championship when she clinched the NHRA Top Fuel title.
I was delighted when I won it in 77, but the ultimate was 1980. That was the one that left an impression. And we went into the final race of the year, a race called the World Finals. We were one of four cars that could win the world championship. It had never ended that close at all. It always had been decided by Indy. We waded through the pack, and we won the world championship along with the race, so that added another $20,000 to the purse, and it was the ultimate day.
Shirley, the match race for Shirley, always was a real good race because even when she wasn't winning in the beginning.
The next race on the Winston Championship Trail was in Western Tennessee. We went to Memphis. The Chief Auto Parts Mid-South Nationals, presented by TNN, jammed the Memphis Motorsports Park facility.
And boy, what a Top Fuel final they saw. They, of course, had watched all the television shows and read all the magazines and heard about this gal named Lori Johns. Well, they got to see her in yet another final, again up against Joe Amato, the same opponent she had to defeat at the previous race in Atlanta.
Lori had to change engines after her second round win, but she ran a 4.99 in the final four. Steve talked with her.
I knew it was going to run a 4.99 just as soon as we got it to make a full pass. It kept having problems. We wheel stood it, we shook it, we threw the blower belt off, we kicked the rods out, and now it's running 4.99, so that's all we need to win this race.
Yeah, we're just glad to be in the final. You know, it's been a tough race, and the teams are all running good right now. So it'll be two times now and we're in the final against Lori, so maybe we can reverse the outcome in the last race. But we'll have us a good drag race either way.
They both staged ever so carefully, and it paid off for Amato. Watch the car in the near lane, and you will see a tenth of a second advantage disappear into a cloud of smoke.
When the clutch started to lock up, it was all over for Joe Amato. Lori Johns took the points and the victory.
For the days, Snake.
The sweet days.
Moving on to Indy 1982, Joe Amato found out that Nitro isn't quite as forgiving as alcohol. Of course, he went on to have a tremendous career in the category.
Yeah, this looks like a grenade. I don't know. It's made a lot of noise. It sounded expensive.
I never heard it quite put like that. Sounds expensive. It is expensive. And I believe he's going to hear that same expensive sound here in a minute, Steve. Losing the blower again in round one. Went through a lot of problems with Amato getting started.
And Joe's weren't the only ears that were ringing. Here again, Scott Collette at near lane. Kaboom for Billy Williams. The parachute burns off instantly. Williams thinks, oh no, not the blower and the race car too. Watch this fancy bit of driving.
He's trying to save the car though, Steve. He's trying to keep further damage from his car by not getting into the catch net.
At Indy 82, Gary Beck was a headline maker. The blue car in the near lane, the first to run under 5.50 seconds, or 5.48 to be exact.
We know the thing. Real car's been real strong the last 3 weeks, and I'm real glad for Larry Miner to have a great running car like this.
But the boldest headline of them all was reserved for Don the Tank Trudeau. In the far lane, Trudeau, with the record sitting at 5.73, runs 5.63.
If I was back home and I heard this was going on here, I wouldn't believe it. But I'm driving the car, and I'm here to tell you the car's doing it. It's an incredible racetrack. It always has been here. And you know, I ran a 73 and come back with a 63.
By their nature, elusive. Just ask Warren Johnson. 16 years ago, the young man from rural Minnesota burst onto the NHRA scene with runner-up finishes at three of NHRA's premier events. Now, those results landed him a close second in the 1976 Winston Point standings, and a championship seemed a matter of destiny. But six long, frustrating years would pass before Warren would win even his first NHRA national event. And for much of the 1980s, he and his cars carried the number two, the eternal bridesmaids in the harsh world of sport, where only championships are valued. Twice, the ultimate prize was snatched from Warren's grasp at the last moment, and the professor of pro stock knew the anguish of the school of hard knocks. But come 1992, all those years of struggle and dedication have paid off. Seven national event victories in 16 races have propelled the thinking man's racer firmly clear of his rivals. And earlier this week in qualifying, Warren clinched that elusive Winston Championship. This was his reaction upon joining the elite brotherhood of pro stock titleists.
Celebration began for the team of Orndorff and Ekman, picking up the opening win of the
just fine after that.
Quite an opportunity for Jeffrey on. The question was, what did the other racers think of the season?
Incredible sights the world of drag racing has ever seen. Here's one of the most incredible drivers. Tom McEwen made his return to Top Fuel Racing at the wheel of Jack Clark Mobile One car.
Of course, Jack Clark, the designated hitter for the Boston Red Sox, longtime resident of Southern California and a huge drag racing fan, whose hero has been Don Garland. And the two finally met face-to-face at the 91 Winter Nationals.
McEwen qualified in the 14th spot with a 5.509, and in the first round, beat Bradley with an elapsed time of a 5.16. McEwen slowed to a 5.29.
Surprisingly, for the defending Winston champion from 1990, Joe Amato, the Winter Nationals has never been his favorite race. He's only won it once, and that was way back in 1980.
He was a little left time, but he got the win by 271 miles per hour.
The finals in Top Fuel Eliminator found Don Prudhomme, who consistently ran 5.0s and a 4.99 in the semifinals. A solid performer all day long. Had some problems back in the pit stop just before the start of the final round. They had to change a fuel pump, and the Skol Bandit crew did an outstanding job in even getting Prudhomme to the starting line to face none other than Frank Bradley for the championship at the Winter Nationals.
Thank you.